first gear, second gear, fourth gear, sixth, eighth, 12th gear! We're talking about manual transmission. You probably know the basic idea. The transmission changes the gear ratio to make sure you're getting the optimum power from your engine to the wheels. When two gears are in mesh, an almost lossless transfer of power occurs. In this case, a force is applied to the gear on the left, which is in turn moving the gear on the right. For every revolution the left gear completes, the right gear completes one in the opposite direction and with equal force. Pretty straightforward. What makes gears truly useful, though, is when they aren't the same size. Let's shrink that driving gear down by half. Now, it has to complete two rotations to move the right gear once. Well, that sucks. But wait a second. The total amount of energy required to move the second gear one revolution hasn't changed. But now the driving gear delivers the same amount of energy over twice as many revolutions, meaning it requires half the amount of force at any given moment. It's like climbing stairs. Make the steps smaller and each step's easier, but you gotta take twice as many. We've all ridden bikes. So you know what it does, but how does it work? A standard manual transmission is made up of an engine shaft, or input shaft, and that's the side that comes from the engine, a drive shaft, or output shaft, that's the side that goes to the drive wheels, and here, underneath both of those, is the counter shaft. And on these shafts are the gears.
How familiar are you with the gear wars exactly?
All of this has to do with getting the right amount of torque to the wheel. If you like learning about torque, check out our science garage on torque and horsepower. If you want to know about toque and hose powder, ask a Canadian.
Bon vivant, bouillabaisse, cul de sac, laissez-faire, chicken cordon bleu.
Now let's get back to the gears.
Okay, it was about 754 years ago.
If I turn the input shaft, the gear on that turns this counter shaft. And that turns all of the gears on the output shaft. But all these gears are moving at different speeds. When the gears aren't engaged, they spin freely from the output shaft because they're not anchored to it. Only one gear at a time is spinning the output shaft. And that's because of what is anchored to the output shaft, these hubs. Around these hubs are sleeves. These sleeves slide over the teeth on the gear and anchor them to the hub to drive the output shaft. But wait, there's more. Look at those tiny little teeth. Matching up those tiny teeth at the edge of our gear with the sleeve's tiny teeth, well, that's almost impossible. So between them are these synchronizers. We cut the power to the counter shaft, let the wheels drive the output shaft for a change, and when we push the synchronizer ring, it gets squeezed against our gear and locks it to the hub, so it's anchored to the output shaft. That's why when you're shifting, you get that Now, the wheels in the drive shaft and the counter shaft are all spinning in mesh. Voila! We've shifted gears. Some manual 5-speed transmissions may have minor differences here or there. This is pretty standard for the most part. The big gear here, which is enmeshed with the smallest gear in the counter shaft, is first gear. First gear is always going to be the largest gear in the transmission, producing more torque for the back wheels. Taking a lot of fast turning force and making one big slow turning force. The slightly smaller gear next to that second. Then goes third and the smallest one's fourth. On most 4- and 5-speed transmissions, fourth gear is what's called direct drive, or a 1-to-1 gear ratio, meaning the input and output are turning at the same rate of speed. Okay, let's pop the shift fork into first gear and engage the big old gear here in the front. And first, this particular transmission's got a gear ratio of 3.83:1, so I can turn the input 1, 2, 3 in exactly 0.8 times, and you can see the output has turned once. That's torque, baby! Pop it into second, and the gear ratio on this guy's 2.062:1. Third gear's 1.4:1. You know the drill. 1 and 0.4 turns it one time. And then, as we mentioned earlier, fourth, 1:1. They're turned at the same speed. That's gear ratios. Guys, we did it! Now, a lot of you are probably saying, what about fifth gear? We're getting there. Fifth gear is kind of hidden in the back here, and we call it overdrive. Remember how first through third gear were high gear ratios? Well, get ready for a low gear ratio, buddy boy. In fifth gear, I only need to turn this shaft 2.8 times to get a full turn on the output. That's overdrive, which gets mucho better fuel economy. And at this point, you're getting powered from the forward momentum of your vehicle and don't need as much power going to your engine or your wheels. Some 6 and 7 speed cars can have double overdrive for even better fuel economy at those high, high speeds. Oh, reverse is over here. Boop, boop, boop. It hits this gear and makes your drive shaft spin the same direction as your counter shaft. Now here's the rub. The drive shaft's attached to the wheels, remember? When we shift gears, the wheels are gonna wanna spin the counter shaft at a different speed than the engine's trying to spin it. We have to take that power off somewhere or it'll make a grinding sound like when your brother's robot hamster won't stop body shaming you, so you throw it in the blender with all the bad forks and spoons and press puree to teach it a lesson. So where do we let all that spinning energy go? The clutch! The clutch looks like this. The clutch has a disc with a high friction material on both sides. The engine is actually driving the flywheel, and the input shaft to the transmission is mounted to the disc. When the disc is pressed firmly against the flywheel, it catches and can drive the shaft. In the case of this clutch, it's squeezed by these springs and attached to a pressure disc and anchored by this pressure plate, which gets bolted to the flywheel. Most clutches use 3 springs, but in performance clutches, you can have more, and that makes the connection between the disc and the flywheel even stronger and more effective in high torque application, like racing. And this is where things get a little tricky. A diaphragm spring is connected to the pressure disc under the pressure plate. When you hit the clutch, it pushes the center of that diaphragm spring, and that pulls up on the springs, which lifts the friction plate off the flywheel. Awesome! Now we've disengaged the power from the shaft. But when you let off the clutch pedal and re-engage the friction disc, you're gonna bang! Pop right into action, and we don't want that. We wanna ease into the movement. So, attached to the friction plate, there's these other plates with coil springs in them. These springs are attached to a hub, and that plate is the one that anchors the shaft, and that goes to the transmission. Those springs absorb the jolt of re-engaging the friction plate to take a little stress off the other parts of your drivetrain. You want to try to get on and off your clutch pretty quickly, or you might burn it out. That happens when the flywheel and the friction plate rub together too much. It happens, usually waiting on a hill to get into a Dodgers game. So what is double clutch?
Granny shifting, not double clutching like you should.
Well, it's not really two clutches. Double clutch is clutching twice. Once when you shift into neutral to hit the gas and match the engine revs to the gear you want to go into. Then you hit the clutch a second time to shift into that gear. I always use the double clutch when I'm racing, driving big rigs, and dunking. I believe I can fly. Pretty cool! Thanks to Honey for sponsoring this video. Honey is a browser extension that automatically scours the interwebs for coupon codes to make sure you're getting the best possible deal. You know how you always get to the checkout and it's like, do you have a discount code? And you're like, no. Well, say no more. It's super easy to install. It's literally 2 clicks and it's free. You know how they say you gotta spend money to make money? Well, that may be true, but you don't have to spend money to save money, because Honey costs you nothing. I used it when I bought new rear struts. Honey just patiently sat in the background until I was ready to check out, and when I was, it found a code and saved me mucho moolah. Searching for codes yourself is often fruitless, and it takes all kinds of math. Do I want free shipping or 20% off? Honey does all that for you to make sure you're getting the best deal out there. That means more money for your Dragons Hatching from Egg sculpture collection. And if it doesn't find a coupon code, well, that's because there isn't one. So you can shop confidently knowing you got the best deal out there. There's no reason not to add Honey to your browser today, like now. It literally takes 2 clicks and costs you no money. Click the link below to add Honey to your browser for free. Or, if you'd rather, type in joinhoney.com/sciencegarage. Honey, click this yellow subscribe button so you never miss an episode of Science Garage. Follow me at BidsBardo and follow Donut at Donut Media. You like replacing your clutch? Check out this video on turbos. You wanna hear about a car with maybe the coolest transmission ever? Check out this up to speed on Koenigsegg. Don't tell my wife I burned out the clutch and had to get it repaired. It's expensive.